Remember when we were talking about the big bands in which Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker first worked together in the early 1940s? Well, these big bands, the Earl Hines and Billy Eckstine bands, served as important training ground for a new generation of bebop musicians who remained active for at least the next 10 years. Included in this new generation are trumpeter Fats Navarro, pianist and arranger Tad Dameron, alto saxophonist Sonny Stitt, tenor saxophonist Gene Ammons, who was the son of boogie-woogie pianist Albert Ammons, you might remember him, Dexter Gordon, Lucky Thompson, Wardell Gray, and even the young trumpeter Miles Davis. We do not have time to discuss all of these musicians, so we will cover a few of them. First, we will discuss Fats Navarro and Tad Dameron, but we'll do them separately, even though they often played and recorded together. Fats Navarro played the trumpet. He was born in Key West, Florida in 1923, and he died tragically young of tuberculosis in 1950. He represents the first true generation of bebop musicians not originally schooled in big band swing. When Dizzy Gillespie left the Billy Eckstine band in 1945, Fats Navarro was his replacement. Navarro's late 1940s collaborations with Tad Dameron led to bebop recordings of exceptional quality. His sound is rich and his eighth note lines are smooth. He has good control in the upper register, but chooses to remain in the mid-range most of the time. In general, his playing is melodic, logical, and doesn't rely on the pyrotechnique so commonly found in Dizzy Gillespie's style. Well, let's go on to Tad Dameron first, before we listen to a little bit of both of them play together. Tad Dameron, his significance is mostly as a composer and arranger. He was also a band leader and a piano player. He was born in Cleveland, Ohio in 1917. He came from a musical family, receiving his first piano lessons from his mother. He developed into a respected jazz pianist, arranger, composer, and band leader. Tad Dameron was one of the first jazz musicians to attempt well-crafted arrangements within the context of the bebop style. In the early 1940s, he wrote arrangements for Harlan Leonard and his Rockets. Later, he was hired to arrange for Dizzy Gillespie's Bebop Big Band. Tad Dameron led small groups from the late 1940s to the mid-1950s that featured many of his original compositions. These compositions are now considered jazz standards and continue to be performed and recorded. Three of his best are Good Bait, Our Delight, and If You Could See Me Now. Some important musicians that played with Dameron's groups include Fats Navarro, Kenny Clarke, Wardell Gray, and, after Fats Navarro died in 1950, the great Clifford Brown spent a short period of time playing with Tad Dameron. We'll discuss Clifford Brown in the near future. Tad Dameron was a proficient jazz pianist who allowed himself minimal solo space, and that was because his talents lay more in composing and arranging. Well, let's listen to a classic Tad Dameron, Fats Navarro recording that is on your listening list. It is entitled Lady Bird. It's a 16-bar form that makes reference to the AAB blues form we've gotten to know. Basically, it is an AABB form, so there is one extra four-measure B section in the form. After the initial melody and form is stated twice, Fats Navarro plays an excellent solo that demonstrates his fat sound and smooth phrasing. It is clear that he was an exceptional trumpet player that would have made many more significant contributions to jazz had he lived longer. After Navarro's solo comes a sax solo, then follows a chorus that is split in half. The first half displays Tad Dameron's talent as an arranger, as the entire band plays impressively together. Then the second half, or last eight measures of the AABB form, is a short piano solo. So, here is Lady Bird by Tad Dameron and Fats Navarro. Thank you. let's turn our attention to an instrument that was neglected by bebop musicians. I am speaking of the trombone. This instrument all but disappeared in the 1940s because it was a struggle for jazz trombonists to figure out how to play fast and angular bebop melodies. The instrument, by and large, wasn't designed to play fast or angular melodies. Rather, it was best suited to imitate a man's voice, mostly in the tenor range. Big band swing trombonists such as Tommy Dorsey or Glenn Miller had very successful careers playing the trombone in this way. It was probably another reason why the older generation was not immediately receptive to the angular and fast melodies of the bebop style. Well, in the late 1940s, a jazz trombonist named J.J. Johnson came forward and figured out how to make the trombone compatible with the bebop style. He was born in Indianapolis, Indiana in 1924. He played with Dizzy Gillespie, Max Roach, Woody Herman, Illinois' Jacquet, Oscar Pettiford, and other important bebop artists in the 1940s and 50s. In the mid-1950s, Johnson and another trombonist named Kay Winding toured and recorded with a bebop rhythm section. J.J. Johnson was the first bebop trombonist to move away from the singing lyrical style of swing, made popular by players like Tommy Dorsey and Glenn Miller that I mentioned before. Johnson also avoided tricky Sam Nanton's plunger-style method of playing the trombone. Remember him? He was one of Duke Ellington's most significant trombonists. J.J. Johnson was the leader of a modern school of jazz trombone playing that incorporated the bebop innovations of Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. It was difficult for most trombone players to execute bebop lines due to the physical limitations of the instrument. J.J. Johnson took trombone technique to a new level by playing the instrument with the virtuosity and finesse of bebop saxophonists and trumpeters. Before we listen to J.J. Johnson, let's discuss one more important bebop jazz musician named Sonny Stitt. Then we can view both of them playing together in a video. Sonny Stitt was an alto and tenor saxophonist. He actually began as an alto saxophonist. He was born in Boston, Massachusetts in 1924, but he grew up in Saginaw, Michigan. Early on, he was a member of Billy Eckstine's band. Then he joined Dizzy Gillespie's bebop big band in 1946. Sonny Stitt established himself first as a bebop alto saxophonist who was so similar to Charlie Parker that he was hailed as the new bird. For a while, he was happy that people were comparing him with the great Charlie Parker. However, eventually, he wanted to be known for his own unique talents rather than simply as an imitator. Therefore, he switched to the tenor saxophone and proved himself to be equally proficient on this instrument as well. He made significant recordings in the late 1940s and throughout the 1950s as both a leader and a sideman. Okay, well, let's watch and listen to both J.J. Johnson and Sonny Stitt play a classic Charlie Parker blues composition called Now's the Time. For a Charlie Parker composition, the melody of Now's the Time is quite simple. Now let's listen to J.J. Johnson play some fast, angular melodies during his solo. He does not do this 100% of the time, but he does enough to get his point across. Thank you. Now let's listen to Sonny Stitt's solo. If you know Charlie Parker's sound and approach, Sonny Stitt sounds so much the same that if you didn't know who it was, you would swear it is Charlie Parker. Hence, Sonny Stitt's nickname, the New Bird. Well, that is all the time we have to cover the bebop style. It was the most revolutionary development in jazz up to that time. It generated as much controversy as it did popularity. In the end, you would have to say it won out because people today have the utmost respect for both the bebop musicians of the 1940s and any later musicians who have played this style well. We now will turn our attention to the next stylistic period in jazz. It is known as cool jazz. Yes, jazz has a style called cool jazz.